everybody. What's up? It's good to be back with you live this week. Work on the building is still in progress, and it's coming along quite nicely. We have a lot of things being completed and ready to go. The time is coming when we're going to be able to meet again in person. It can't come soon enough. I cannot wait to be back in the house of the Lord together again. If you're new with us today, I want you to take just a second and pull out your smartphone, dumb phone, whatever you have, and just shoot us a real quick message. Please send the word new to the number 681-202-202-3364. I'll repeat that since I stumbled. 681-202-2364. We want to connect with you, and we want to be able to share some things with you of some upcoming things that are happening at our church. But so last week we took an unexpected break from the series of Thankful. But we're back on track for this weekend, and we want to get into week two of this thing we call Thankful. In this crazy world that we're living in right now, we are dealing with this crazy election cycle, this thing that doesn't seem like it's ever going to end. We're dealing with COVID, people stuck in seclusion and depression and anxiety setting in at a monumental pace. It's sheer madness right now, to be quite honest. But I think it's extremely important for all of us to kind of have an inner peace, a sense of contentment, knowing where our source of provision lies and who we could trust in all this madness that is happening all around us on a daily basis. This is what we're going to be discussing a little bit today, and we've been here a few times through the past into this scripture, but I think it's deserving right now to revisit it during such a time as we're dealing with right now. We will be looking in the book of Philippians today. We will be in chapter 4, verses 10 through 13. I'll be reading out of the NIV today, but whatever version you have, it'll be very similar. So don't worry if you don't have your Bible even today, or you are watching this on your Bible, your glowing Bible. The scriptures will be on the screen below me if you don't have yours today. If you don't have a Bible, I would encourage you to please get one. I truly believe that it's the roadmap that's going to get you through life's battles and life's trials that always seem to come our way. There are several good options, some free options that are even available on your App Store or Google Play Store. That you could go in and get. The Bible app is a great place to start looking for the whole. It's got the whole Bible with all kinds of different translations and devotionals and everything else. It's what I personally use, and it is free. Thank you to Life Church and the different ministries that Life Church has for bringing us the Bible app that we can open up and crack open the Word of God wherever we may be, whatever trouble we're going through. We can open it up to His Word and find the direction that we're seeking so much in our life. So let's begin today with this passage of Scripture that we're going to discuss from Philippians 4, 10 through 13. I'm going to silence my phone just in case people start calling me. But we are going to talk a little bit about Paul again today. Paul is such a great reference point for us to look back in these times of trouble and see exactly how Paul dealt with a lot of the things that were going on in his time. So Philippians 4, 10 through 13, it says, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed my concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I want you to underline that part in your Bible today, that I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or living in want. And then probably one of the most notable scriptures in all the Bible, and that is the 13th scripture here. It says, I can do all things, all of this, through Him who gives me strength. Let's pray real quick before we get started. Lord, I thank You for this day. I thank You for Your many provisions in this life. I ask You to speak through me today. Give me the right words to say. Speak to Your people. Feed your sheep. Lord, today we're just coming before You. We have a lot of people in our congregation, that in our friend group, in our family group, that is dealing with this COVID situation. Lord, I just ask You to be with them. Carry them through, even with the death that we had in our congregation this 2 weeks ago. Lord, I just ask You to be with the family as they go through services on Sunday. Lord, keep them close, draw them near, let them know that You're there. Lord, we love You today. We can't thank You enough for Your word and what Your word means to us. Lord, help us that we'll never take this church thing and meeting together and coming together in a Bible study for granted ever again. Lord, you're a good God. We love You. We can't thank You enough for the many things that You've blessed us with. And it's in Your mighty and holy name that we pray. And amen. Amen. In 2013, as I was looking at this message this week, in 2013, there was a study that was conducted with children in the UK from families whose annual income was more than $100,000. And what the study showed might surprise you as it did me. Researchers found issues such as eating disorders, drug abuse, depression, self-harming were soaring among wealthy teenagers. This information doesn't fit the assumption that if we just had money, then we would be happy. Because you could buy whatever you want and have whatever you want in this life. The children in this study are in a wealthy environment, but are far from happy. See, as humans in this world that we live in, we are so conditioned to believe that the wealth, the sex, the celebrity status, etc., 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 is where we get our value from and where we get our worth from. This has been driven into our brains from the TV to the radio to social media, our friend group, everywhere we look. Is we're surrounded by this, beating it into our brains. But I have to tell you today that it's a lie straight from the pits of hell. Money can't buy you happiness. Material things won't make you happy. That boy or girl of your dreams will not make you happy. These things are just a way of Satan to take your mind off of God and the blessings He has given each and every one of us, because He knows that there is no way that we'll ever reach what our mind thinks we should do. We will never be happy. Contentment will never be found when we're striving for something that has a hold on us. I want you to remember this today, out of this message, that discontentment is the fastest route to hell on earth. Discontentment is the fastest route to hell on earth. If you want to live a crazy, destructive lifestyle, if you want to live in a hell for the rest of your life, trying to measure up to some standard that you'll never meet, discontentment is where it starts. It leads us down deadly and dreadful into dreadful lives. The Bible calls us to be set apart. Not so that we shun everyone that is not like us. That's not what it's saying. but it is to remind us that we need to be different in how we handle these things, this junk that goes on in our lives, this craziness that happens. We are supposed to handle it differently. We are supposed to be set apart by the way that we deal with these conflicts and these different things that are going on in our beings. It's really a battle of mindset. Today, this isn't in my notes, but I'm going to look it up on my phone real quick because it just hit me. And I had it pulled up earlier today, and I was going to put it in this sermon, and I said no, but God is telling me yes for this evening's or for today. So I'm gonna share this with you. I just said that it's all a battle of the mindset. And a famous singer, Danny Gokey, a famous Christian singer, he put out a post this week, and I want to read it to you because it caught my attention when he posted it. It says, everybody goes through difficult times. Everybody goes through junk in their lives. But your attitude, your mindset, determines how long you stay there. Everybody goes through difficult times, but your mindset determines how long you stay there. The Apostle Paul appears to have come from a life of an elite background, but sets it all aside for the joy of knowing and serving Jesus Christ. Paul took everything the wealth brought him and threw it all away because he found out that it couldn't bring him true happiness in this life. Paul wrote this letter we're looking at today, Philippians, from a Roman prison. Yet in it, he describes that he's described as being content. How in the world does this happen? That's what most of us are saying right now. How in the world could he find contentment from a prison cell? Three hots and a cot. How in the world could you find contentment in all of that? In Philippians 3, 4 through 7, he lays out the fact that he came from a very Torah observant family from the tribe of Benjamin, and he had gained a reputation for his zeal in persecuting the church. He loved it. He was good at it. Elsewhere in Scripture, we learn that Paul had Roman citizenship. Citizenship in the Roman Empire was a highly prized citizenship. Scholars note that one could only achieve Roman citizenship in these five ways. One, they could be born to a Roman father. So Paul, in his case, a citizen of a Roman colony is number two. Number three, a retired auxiliary soldier. Number four, a part of a municipal aristocracy, because I can't say words, y'all know this, or other group of honored, another group that was honored by Rome as a military force. Number five. And this was most common after being born in Rome or in a colony. A slave was freed by his or her owner. We know he was well educated from the quality of the Greek that he wrote, and he studied under the famous person in Jerusalem, and you can find that in Acts 22:3. We're not going to get into that today, but we also know that he was a tradesman. He worked as a tent maker. And by the time that he accounts Jesus on the Damascus Road, he could say he was living the dream. He was wealthy. He had everything the wealth could bring him. He had everything that he had dreamed up in his mind. He had made it, but The one thing that he did not have was contentment. And yet after meeting Jesus and on this road to Damascus, this is what he said personally about his life. He said, "Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I count them all as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ." None of the status and accomplishments in Paul's life brought the satisfaction he later found in knowing Jesus Christ. Enough was never enough for Paul. You see, enough is never enough in our lives either. But when he met Christ, he considered everything else rubbish, everything else trash, everything else excrement, and felt there was nothing better than knowing Jesus. So who is in control when it comes to your life? Is it your career, your relationships, your longing for possessions? But I think the greater question in all of that is, do you possess them or do they possess you? Because there's a big difference. Do you possess them or do they possess you? Is Paul saying that we should settle for less in our lives? Absolutely not. No. Paul has lost everything, but in the process of losing it, it turns out that he has, in fact, gained everything. As he puts it, "For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ." So there is the loss of everything his identity had been based upon, and then those things turn out to be nothing more than crap. In the moment of what he would have previously considered tremendous loss in his life, there is instead great gain. Paul learned that we will not be content in this life until we realize that Jesus Christ is better than anything else we are spending our time pursuing. Enough will never be enough. This is what Paul begins to elaborate on in the next chapter of Philippians. The church in Philippi had brought some provisions to Paul in Rome. Paul then goes on to say something profound, almost impossible really, that he doesn't experience need, for he's learned to always be content in his life. So it isn't that he doesn't find himself out of bread or lacking a roof over his head at night, but rather, no matter the situation, he is content with what he has. He says, "I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty of hunger in abundance of need." He has experienced both hunger and abundance, and regardless of what he is facing in his life, he has learned how to face it with contentment. So what is the secret today? We find the secret to this passage in verse 13. the scripture that we find so many times on our football helmets. The scripture that we find so often floating around Facebook that I think that sometimes we've become so accustomed to seeing it and so accustomed to saying it that I don't know if we really think that it matters anymore. We forget the meaning of the scripture. But I have to tell you today that this scripture means so much to the mindset of getting past all this discontentment in your life. It says, I can do all things through Him who strengthens me. It's nothing that you're going to do on the inside. It's nothing that money's going to buy. It's nothing that possessions are going to fix. The only thing that's going to make you content in your life is to put all of your faith and all of your needs and all of the things of this that this world has to offer and place them in God's hands. Remember 2 weeks ago when we looked at the definition of the Greek word for contentment. And the primary meaning of the word was to be possessed of unfailing strength. That unfailing source of strength comes from Jesus Christ alone. And God enables Paul to be strong enough when faced with nothing and when he is faced with more than he'd ever need, not to lose sight of what matters in his life. In each and every situation, he has the strength required to have a healthy relationship in any environment that he's in. We can also be content in Christ because we know that the supply, that he will supply our every need. Paul makes the point a few verses later in Philippians. He describes his situation as well supplied. Due to the gifts of the congregation that the congregation of Philippi had given him already. Paul recognizes that when the prospects are looking bleak, that God is there with helping hands. And he turns this gift into praise. Paul says of Philippians 4, 19-20. He said, and my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. The praise of Paul was a promise to us. The praise of Paul is a promise to us that God will supply our every need. Have you experienced provision in your life? I know we all have. What is that story of provision in your life? And have you told your friends and family what that story is? We can be content in God by trusting that He will supply our every need because of this. Whether we're in abundance or we're hungry, we'll be okay. I want to challenge you this week to write up a little story or think of it in your mind about the provision that God has given you in your life. Whether you want to record it or whether you just want to write it down, I encourage you to go out and share it on your favorite social media platform, whether it be Facebook, Twitter, Parler, MeWe, whatever the case may be. Go out and share your story and your the provision that God has given you in your life. You see, we have heard the good news. We have seen the provision of God in our own lives. Now it's time for us to go out and share it with our family and our friends. It's time to tell the whole world about this good news that we found in Him. And what better week to do this than the upcoming Thanksgiving week? To share the gospel with our family and our friends, and to be thankful for all that He has given us in our lives. And who knows? Maybe seeing the provision in your life will set you apart. And that family member that you've been praying for so long, that friend that you've been praying for so long, sees your story of provision that God has given you, and may turn their lives around and say, I want some of that Jesus stuff too. I need whatever this person has in my life. Let's pray today as we end. I'm coming into this Thanksgiving season. Lord, I thank You. Lord, I'm so thankful for the family that You've given me, the beautiful wife, my kids. Lord, I thank You for our church family, our live fam that meets every week online. Lord, I thank You for every single one of our volunteers, our pastoral staff. Lord, everybody that You've brought into my life, I am so blessed and I'm so thankful for You. Lord, I thank You for the provisions that You've given me in my life. The times where we didn't have two pennies to rub together, and you've made something come through. You've made something work. Lord, you're just that good. Lord, help us as we go through this life to learn to be content. Because we can do all things through You because of You and Your strength. Lord, I just ask You this week to be with all of us as we sit around the dinner tables, or whether we're on live chat. Maybe we can't meet this week together because of COVID. But Lord, I just ask You that as we are in our own separate spaces, that we can be thankful. Instead of focusing on the COVID problem and the stuff that's going on all around us, that we can focus on You and Your provision and Your goodness in our lives. Lord, help us that we'll go out and share this story of Your provision to everyone that we meet, to our friends and family, so they can come to know You as their saving healer also. Lord, we love You. We can't thank You enough for everything that You're doing. Lord, I ask You to be with us this week. It's in Your mighty and holy name that we pray, and amen. Thank you guys for coming out and worshiping with us today. We can't wait to see you back in the new, I guess you would want to call it the sanctuary, in the upcoming few weeks. If you have the time, come out and check it out. Maybe work a couple hours. Let's try to get this thing done together so we can get back to worshiping and doing what God has called us to do. You have a great week, and we love you.